The movement toward racial equality encompasses so many different aspects.
News 4's Carice Jackman continues our conversation for Change Now with a look at what these activists are calling their top priorities.
Now, the push towards racial equality has a lot of facets, obviously. What is your number one priority right now that you would like to see change, if you could do so today?
I believe that Black people, we are specific people with very specific issues that require very specific solutions. And I do not believe that we have to focus on one specific issue simply because our oppression is so complex. You can't fix one thing without trying to fix the other. But I think that one thing we all can focus on in light of the police brutality in this country is defunding the police. We hear a lot of talk about defunding the police or abolishing the police. I think the two are very different. I think that for a city like Nashville, defunding the police is a first step to abolition, if abolition is what the people want. But I think for me, defunding the police is my main priority.
Yeah, I would say, I think if we're talking about racial justice, I'll speak to, you know, the experiences and the hope for Black people as a Black person. Mm-hmm. And as a Black queer person, right, definitely believe deeply in Black queer feminism and centering the folks who are like most marginalized, so starting with Black trans folks. And so if I'm starting with Black trans people, I'm also thinking about what participatory democracy and participatory governance. And so for too long, we've seen our communities be left out of not just the electoral process, but also the governing process. And we've seen that elected officials held unaccountable, elected officials who are deeply invested in economic growth rather than actually growth and care for the people have gone without accountability. So I'm deeply interested in what it looks like to engage our communities around a participatory democracy and participatory governance process to be like, friends, family, what are the issues that you feel most harm you, and what are solutions that we want to see happen? What we can do now is continue to engage and talk to each other, right? For me, I'm very clear about community organizing, being a part of what it looks like to transform our communities, and that means talking to each other, being like, hey, friend, what are the complex issues that are impacting your life? What are the ways that they are like intersecting and impacting each other, and how do we go and create a budget that actually makes us all whole? So for me, it's a budget fight and like a community fight.
I think that's beautiful, and I also wanted to mention right here is like centering the most marginalized of us is the way that we all get liberated. If we liberate the most marginalized of us, we all can feel that, you know what I'm saying? And as long as the most marginalized of us, whether it's trans folks or any of our target groups inside of our Black community, are not centered, we are not liberated, no matter how many people get access to the privilege. But I wanna say the number one thing for me is, in addition to what was just being said, is that we're creating systems that defend all Black life, right? Whether that's a budget, whether that's talking about like making sure that we have alternatives to police, like that actually solve community violence and that actually can solve violence between neighbors, which we know is how it starts, and disagreements, and work to actually code that, right? And replace the anti-Blackness policies that are encoded right now in our traditional accountability structures. So I think like really, really making sure that we defend all Black lives at all levels, whether that's the budget, whether that's the policies, whether that's the literally like functioning of the system on the ground, I think is my number one priority at this point in time. Yeah.
Just one thing that feels really important right now in the middle of a pandemic is we have loved ones who are inside a jail, pretrial detention right now, being operated by the Sheriff's Department, who are at risk of actually dying in jail. We have loved ones who are in, and family members, and community members who are in jails and in prisons across the state, who are, like, their lives are at risk right now because, one, they are not getting the health care they need, they do not have the PPE they need, and so that's one immediate demand. Like, let our people out of cages so that they can, like, actually survive this crisis.
One thing you did say, Erica, you mentioned allocating money to help Black people in different forms and facets. One thing I want to definitely mention is mental health. I know a lot of times when officers are called, sometimes someone may have a mental health issue, and I know that people have talked about adequate training to help those who are mentally ill, especially in the Black community. Is that something that you would also like to see change too?
Yeah, I think I just want to be clear that police officers, the Sheriff's Department should not be responding to mental health issues, to mental health crises. And so a lot of the vision the policy implementations and the budgetary work that we can do is invest in public services that already do that work, and to invest in institutions that can do that work. And just want to be really clear that we don't go down this line of deciding not to incarcerate people in jail, in prison, and then decide to incarcerate, like, overly decide that black people have mental health issues as another way to control black people. Mm-hmm. So that feels very important that we make that clear. But I think, yes, we want to see community care in our community, where if people are having mental health crises, they have the support they need. That includes, like, if they want medication, access to that medication, that is public, that is funded and paid for by the state if people cannot pay for it. And then I think also community care workers who can help and assist families and communities who are dealing with that issue as one, I think is one part of it.
And I want to stick, and I think that's very important, because I want to stick a note in his, who are community members, mm-hmm. right? Because we know that the system mutates, right? So we know we don't want people to then be locked up in cushier jails mm-hmm. that are just a transformation of something that was already dark into something that just looks cushy. Because we know also across the country, we're having prisons that rebrand themselves as care centers. Mm-hmm. Same cages, same jails, mm-hmm. same COs. And so we just need to guard against that by literally making sure that whatever we create, one, is brand new, and two, centered on community members and people who actually live here.